Il y a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 personnes, 6 personnes. Et évidemment, j'ai envie de casser leur compte. Et c'est pour ça qu'hier, je vous ai demandé de venir ici. Bien sûr.
Darling, I've told you there's no way I'm going to sign a contract for Arena until I've sent this to my lawyers and then to another hospital.
We'll move on now to last night's Arena. Molly, what did you think?
I think people who want to shock the world, and that is their whole ambition, are so boring.
What I'm trying to understand is why you're so... What it is you're so worried about me? What it is you're resisting?
On the surface, our life appears to be really quaint and charming.
Yes, doesn't it? But underneath, it's a steaming cauldron of sexual perversion, drugs, and twisted neurosis.
Oh, you're the fella from the BBC!
That is, whoops, the original bottle, which has kind of seen better days.
Thank you all for coming today to this exclusive preview screening of No Direction Home, Bob Dylan. I'll now hand over to Anthony Wall, editor of Arena, the long-running and award-winning art strand on BBC television, which is now in its 30th year.
30 years of Arena, I couldn't think of anything that would represent more perfectly what we've strived to do and aspired to than the condition of Bob Dylan in the key creative years that this film deals with, seen through the eyes and understanding of Martin Scorsese.
Hey, Mr. Tambourine Man, play a song for me. I'm not sleepy, and there is no place I'm going to.
And I think, again, from our point of view, it probably represents about as far as you could go with the whole idea of arts on film, arts on television. So let's begin.
Mr. Brooks.
What?
Do you think we might get a chance to talk?
Who are you?
The BBC.
Oh, yes, that's right. The Bengal Broadcasting Company, right? You're the Indian that was supposed to interview me?
From London.
Oh, from London?
Yeah.
Ah, what's your name?
Alan.
Alan what?
Yentl.
You're a Jewish Indian. Ah, the best.
Arena was really the invention of Humphrey Burton. He wanted an arts magazine. He arrived as head of music and arts, and Arena was born. And it was split up into these three categories: art and design, cinema, and theatre.
I ran the programmes to do with the visual arts, and it was moderately successful. It was, you know, it was an okay programme. Alan took over Arena, changed it utterly, I mean, removed the entire magazine element, turned it into a single programme to the Arena we came to know.
The canvas was very wide, and any subject was possible, but the approaches were always different. So even a familiar subject would have a different approach. So in making the journey with George Melly, it was about an exhibition at the Hayward Gallery, but ended when it arrived at the Hayward Gallery.
Beware of the period ahead. Already this world is cracking.
The arts department, Omnibus Arena, all those programs were based at Kensington House, which was famous for being a kind of hotbed of radical program makers.
It was a place absolutely passionately concerned with culture. The environment in which Arena grew up, a sort of protected, slightly maverick sort of organization, with somebody as the editor, Alan, who had an immense political savvy nous. He knew exactly how to deal with the upstairs. And around him gathered this group of yobs, really. Yeah, not yobs, but sort of, shall we say, dissidents.
My name's Jack,
Arena became first very famous for doing the film essay on this single subject. That began because a producer of the older generation from us called Christopher Burstall had done an omnibus program about the poem Tiger, Tiger. And he simply went to all sorts of people to get interpretations of it. He got school children to recite it. He made an entire omnibus on the subject of a single poem.
Some things stick in your mind and others don't, and that's one of the ones that does.
It took you into this world, not only of Blake, but of the poem itself. And what struck me was that there was some sense of entering into a magical world for 50 minutes that you then left, that the television had enabled you to visit. Almost like an Alice in Wonderland type thing. And I began to see the television as a sort of wonderland.
Blake's wondering whether it's made by the devil or God.
I think that's very good. I think Blake is wondering that in a way, yes. And what do you think his answer is? Do you think he decides who made it?
I think he decides in the end that God made it.
What makes you say that?
Well, I assume he's a Christian. And in the last line he says, who dares to frame the symmetry of a tiger? And, well, if he's a good Christian, could only be one person who would dare to.
Do you go to church?
No, I'm an atheist.
But that single subject essay done by a real filmmaker, by a film director, was the kind of mainstay of Arena. It led to the idea of applying that same idea to popular culture.
And so I face the final curtain. My friend.
My Way was the sort of great experiment because Anthony wanted to do something. We were still doing magazine items that day. It could have been a short film. And Anthony was said, can I work on this program? I've got this great idea about this song, My Way.
The great thing about My Way was we weren't absolutely sure what we were doing. It felt like going on a sort of kind of crazy adventure. And the fact that we didn't know what we were doing, I now see in retrospect, was absolutely fantastic, because when you don't know what you're doing, it could be a problem. But on the other hand, you could be doing something that's new. I thought it was a spectacularly absurd way of describing your existence, whoever you were. I was fascinated by the number of people who felt that it did.
Somebody singing, da dee da da, it's regrets I've had a few. And saying I've had a few regrets, so regrets I've had a few. Particular word few. Okay, off we go then, choir.
Even if you thought the song was completely appalling, or whether you did think it summed up your life, one way or another, everybody was asking themselves, have I done it my way? In any kind of, and it's kind of, it's a rather terrifying question to ask yourself.
And more than having lived the life at school, more than having travelled every highway, more than having had every office in this land open to me except Prime Minister, more than all of that, the fact that I did it my way.
It struck a chord, definitely, which taught me something about how tension works in films. That if you can come up with an idea that 90% of it is already in the viewer's head, then you've got a good start, but it's very difficult to think of them.
I've lived a life this
morning. Of course, in those days, you made the programme, and then it went out, and that was it. And if you missed it, you missed it. And there was something kind of throwaway about our attitude to the song and the subject. So it sort of kind of negated a kind of preciousness which people often say is the thing they most dislike about arts programs. It was in the nature of the subject to completely blow all that out of the water.
I do remember at the beginning the relationship with Anthony and Nigel that I think I have to say made for the defining characteristic of Arena.
I mean, Anthony came onto the scene and a very, very bright man.
I think he'd done his degree in Beatles lyrics. So that was fairly modernist in those times. Whereas Nigel had done history of art. And that informed everything, all the work that he did.
Of all the cities I've ever visited, the one most totally given over to the idea of success is New York. All those people down there are either hurrying or sauntering toward what they call the big time. And if my voice were loud enough, I would now shout down to them to explain that all they need is to have a lifestyle of their very own. And it's appropriate that I should be standing on this balcony to discuss this matter, because this is the hotel where the great stylists have lived.
The Chelsea has attracted artists who are so off the wall, you couldn't make it up. The magic was very much in the Chelsea Hotel in that kind of way before we arrived.
Because that was a sort of a huge success, classically put together, very beautifully shot and appealing to all the camp things in Nigel's personality.
Tennessee Williams stayed here probably when he first came to New York. Oh, notice what they're doing in the painting. This looks sort of like a Jackson Pollock. One time Jackson Pollock stayed here. So all the immortals of the 20th century at one time...
I'll tell you what he was good at. He was good at moving tableaus. He was good at setting up shots. You saw some of these pictures and they were just gorgeous. I mean, so gorgeous that you want to sort of lick the telly. He was good at sort of poking subjects with a sort of metaphorical stick and making them animate in sort of unexpected ways, because he was a sort of rather gruff and barky sort of person.
When I was a student, Alice B. Toklas's recipe for cake was famous.
Oh, you mean the marijuana brownies? Well, there's another recipe.
But he was absolutely crap at narrative. So putting stories together was a very, very painful process.
He was this extraordinary presence, Nigel. He was dressed outrageously. He was an aesthete, actually, was Nigel, in his person and in the way he presented himself.
Bring on the 499, which is the Bar Cortina. My goodness me, and here we go. The Great British Institution. The Great British Institution. We don't call all of them board.
The Cortina arose out of a shared interest that Nigel Finch and I had in the things that go on that aren't normally identified as being artistic endeavour, but people are very passionate about them. The people who were half man, half Cortina, the quirks of human existence, and it's such a British thing. Again, it was moving into areas that I think would have been deemed to be inappropriate or just, quite frankly, vulgar. Again, we met some real characters, and we knew that they should be on television. And probably this is where we were starting to cross over with other areas. I mean, not far off Esther Ranson, quite frankly.
Don't knock British cars, for some are first rate. Foreign Datsuns, etc., make me shudder. They just can't compare with this old bugger.
Nigel had two films going at that time. One was Chelsea Hotel and one was Cortina's. My editing style by then had got a bit punky, right, a little bit more sort of visual aggression. Not that Nigel had much sympathy with that, really.
Which car was sent on a ski run in Italy as a publicity stunt?
Cortina.
Correct. Which is Britain's most frequently stolen car?
Cortina.
Correct. To date, how many Ford Cortinas have been produced in Britain?
4,900,983.
82 actually, but I'll accept it.
Any questions?
Where do you start with those things? I mean, certainly we had no point of reference. There's nothing that we could call up and say, oh, well, if we do it like that, we'll get somewhere with this. And I think it was a hell of a struggle, to be honest.
I saw
Ford Cortina quite recently. I hadn't seen it for years. And it looked fantastically fresh. It looked very sort of modern, very now. It looked like most television. So maybe someone watching it who came to it sort of like completely fresh, you think, well, what's so special about this? But you have to remember when it came out, it was completely groundbreaking. And its influence, I think its influence can be seen everywhere, not just in terms of getting ordinary people to talk about their own obsessions, but also the way it's done, the way it's shot, the way it's framed, the way it's constructed.
It's just a hobby, like collecting stamps. Just so happens my hobby, I drive around in.
We were very lucky. It was an unusual time. This was a space which was not supervised. There were no security guards around the perimeter. We were allowed to get up the stuff. And also they got big audiences. The Ford Cortina, Desert Island Disc, those ones about popular culture did incredibly well with the audience.
Radio 4. Now it's 9:05 and time for Desert Island Disc.
Sounds and sweet airs that give delight and hurt not. Sometimes a thousand twangling instruments will...
With Desert Island Disc, there was a lot of how can you make a film about a radio program? And that was great because it meant that people had no expectations about what they were going to see. There was nothing for them to feel, oh, right, that's it then, that's exactly what I thought it was going to be. There was only the possibility of surprise. Desert Island Disc probably is the single greatest broadcasting idea that anybody's ever had.
What I needed was an idea strong enough for a series of 6 programs. I was just about to get into bed, and then I had the inspiration.
When I got to know Roy, he's one of the most extraordinary human beings that I've ever come across. And I remember I had to try and bite my lip the whole time because, I mean, he would say things like, well, the sun's over the yard arm, do you fancy a little drink? I mean, he absolutely was everything that you thought he should be, and at that time something utterly uncool. But I felt that in there was something that was much kind of on the money, was sharper and hipper and potentially stranger. I realized that there were 2 great classic interviewing techniques in the history of television. There's John Freeman torturing Hancock to tears, bringing up all his worst aspects and making him come face to face with them like some psychiatrist from hell. And then there's Roy, and he asked them these rather pressing questions in the nicest possible way.
How well could you endure loneliness?
How well could I endure loneliness? I don't really know. When I was a kid, I never used to mind it too much.
What I was trying to do was do the documentary equivalent of an Ealing comedy. And Roy appeared to be in an Ealing comedy, which was about a bloke on a desert island who kept being visited by famous people. I just liked the craziness, the Englishness. I felt Desert Island Disc, very much like My Way, was a sort of kind of elephant in the room too big for anybody to see it.
Castaways, yes, of course, we ought to have some ideas for castaways. Captain Bligh. What am I talking about, Captain Bligh? No, I've got one written down here. Baroness Maria von Trapp, you know, the Sound of Music lady. What about her? She'd be excellent.
And for all of us, there would be artists who have changed our lives in a way that I think most people who are probably watching this program have had an experience like that. And that would come down to we all had our list of people that we really, really wanted to make programs about just because we were so... admire them so much.
Alan Yentob came to me and said, look, I'm pursuing Orson Welles. Do you want to do the film? And I said, not half.
I'm glad to be back, Mr. Keene.
I'm always glad to be back, young man. I'm an American. Always been an American. Anything else? When I was a reporter, we had some quicker than that. Come on, young fella.
Well, what do you think? I was quite scared because I'd heard all these stories about Orson, you know, saying to an interviewer, okay, you have 3 questions, and the interviewer would say, couldn't I have a few more? And he'd say, now you have 2 questions, you know, that sort of thing. And we walked in, and this is my co-producer Alan Yentob, myself, and an American crew. We'd hired an American crew, and Orson Welles was standing there, and there was complete silence. And I'd never seen Alan Yentob lost for words, but I was waiting for Alan, since he'd done the courting, to say, oh, this is your interviewer, Leslie, and Alan completely. Eventually, the sound recorder said, hello, Mr. Wells, my name's Sam, how are you? And shook hands, and that broke the ice. We sat down to do this interview without any agreement about how long he was going to sit with us. And with us, of course, hoping we were going to get the entire story from him. And there is a moment after the third question when he says something like, this is going okay. You can almost feel the whole room kind of go, whew. And we just knew it was going to be okay. He was going to stay with us. And he stayed there for 8 hours. He just talked nonstop for 8 hours.
I like that very much. I think that's true. And I seldom like anything that's said about my films. So we're off to a good start.
Early on, I realized that this would work as a real conversation. And so I decided to react just as I would in a conversation. And he did make me laugh.
Do you actually think the director is overrated?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
And I realized that at some point he knew what I was doing, because, you know, he's a pretty good director himself. So he started playing up to it. There was a point at which every interviewer's nightmare, the question that you can't quite get to the end of, because you weren't quite sure of it when you started, it goes on and on and on.
Stay up all night with your leading players, that you will invite a kind of collaboration that seems to me quite, really quite unusual. And we run out of film.
You had me. I'd be riveted. I love everything. Don't cut a word out of that.
Somebody called it later, someone in the press called it the greatest performance of his life, because he was playing himself.
Passionately.
It was the most unforgettable day I ever had working in television. At the end of it, we said, do you want to have dinner? And he said, No, I want to go home and watch television, because it's the Oscars. So there's Orson Welles, who'd never won an Oscar, by the way. He'd shared one once for writing the screenplay of Citizen Kane, but going off to watch the Oscars at home on telly.
Sometimes just a person sitting there talking and saying something really, really interesting is quite as effective as any number of, you know, fancy images. So the value of the talking head and the value of what a really interesting person has to say was always, I think, built into the heart of the programme somewhere.
In 1985, I became head of music and arts, and I left Arena. I felt that Anthony and I just should run it, and that's what happened.
And first, a new category, the Best Arts Programme.
So how do you choose the topics? Do you just argue it out between you?
Well, obviously, it's our own ideas, a sort of rather off-the-wall subjects that might not have been considered appropriate for an arts series.
They definitely had a bit of a telepathy going on. They knew what each other was thinking a lot of the time, even though a lot of the time they appeared to be different. And there's one departmental when they both, somebody made some mistake, and they both stood up together and said exactly the same question. The new secretaries who arrived, you tend to bond with one of them and be frightened of the other. And people tended to bond with Nigel first, I think, slightly nervous of Anthony. Whereas I bonded with Anthony straight away. I was terrified of Nigel for ages.
Dear Graham Greene, I'm writing to ask if you'd be interested in participating in a project for Arena. I know that you've refused to have a conventional documentary made about you before, but having just finished reading your autobiography, I was very taken by the story you tell about the man who's been roaming the world pretending to be you, the one you call the other.
Volume was high with Nigel. He was quite dramatic. One of my worst moments ever was with Nigel. He was away filming in America for about 3 months, And well, right at the beginning, when he was just gone away, Graham Greene wrote to him and left his personal phone number in the south of France, which he never gave to anybody. So I rang Nigel, said, he's got this phone number. He said, OK, well, I can't ring him while I'm away. Keep hold of the letter. So 3 months later, he came back, and I couldn't find the letter. And he was absolutely climbing the walls, furious, made me feel absolutely terrible. Luckily, by the next morning, I had thought what I was doing at the time and found it carefully in a book. But he did talk to me for a really long time after that.
Dear Nigel Finch, thanks for your letter. Do you believe that people will understand that everyone is as much a fake as the other himself seems to have been? Yours ever, Graham Greene.
I received a summons one day to meet him the next day for coffee at the Ritz in London. And I'd never met him before, and turned up at the appointed time. There was no Mr. Greene staying at the Ritz, and I mentioned my name, and he'd left a message for me, and I was sent up to the top floor to meet someone, I can't remember his name now, someone staying there under a pseudonym. And I got to the top floor, and the entire corridor of the Hotel of the Ritz was stretched ahead of me, and at the far end of it was Graham Greene. So he had the duration of the corridor to size me up. And I got there, and he said, "Good morning, Mr. Finch," in his instantly recognisable, gravelly voice. "Good morning, Mr. Finch." He says, "I don't like the way this film's going. You're getting too close to me. I think we'll have to put an end to it."
For many years, I found myself in search of someone who called himself Graham Greene. Photographs in a Geneva newspaper and a Jamaican one.
I did ask him, I said to him, "I don't understand why you're not prepared to appear on film, yet you're prepared to be interviewed and you're prepared to be photographed."
"The other calls himself Graham Greene. Perhaps his name is Graham Greene."
I was always worried he would appear, because it would have completely screwed up the whole premise of the film. At the same time, of course, I couldn't resist asking him whether he would, and he, as a gentleman, said no. But I suppose every filmmaker must hold out the hope that the big fish will one day say, "Okay, I'll sit down and I'll talk."
Wasn't house style. There was no remit at all. So, I mean, the important thing was, is the idea interesting? Is this an interesting thing to make 60 Minutes about? And that was the overriding thing. How you did it was completely up for grabs.
"I'm Mick the Fish, and this is my dog Pikey. He's an English Bull Terrier, a very big English Bull Terrier.
How long have you had him?"
"I've had him for 6 years.
The thing about the Old Kent Road was that it was an attempt to do something very domestic, very simple, about something that's very familiar, that people think they know a lot about, but in fact when you actually get down and start to reveal stuff, it turns out to be quite surprising."
"Well, we get a lot of villains in.
Villains?
Well, you know, we know them, but you don't ask where they get their money from, so..."
"Can you sort of spot a villain?"
"Probably can, yeah. Well, I can, I don't know about you."
And of course, some of the characters in the film, their persona, if you like, it's like almost medieval, I suppose.
"Madam, in those days I wasn't working for cards, I was in gent business. Made to measure only. Now, babe, should be here, that man. Measure."
They do look quite slow compared to the way in which things are done now, and there is a pace and a sort of sedate quality about some of them. You know, sometimes that second after, before you cut, when you stop asking the questions or whatever, you know, when, you know, it's that moment where something's actually revealed in someone's body language or whatever, so you just want to just give people and give the pictures a chance to breathe, because when you do, other stuff is revealed.
fundamentally it's a director's program. What we're looking for is the director's singular vision on the whole thing, no matter how much or how little help that they might need. People had different, often extremely substantial personalities. That would be part of what was exciting about it. And also could be kind of, could be difficult, you know, because obviously very strong, forceful personalities have also have a point of view which might not coincide with your own.
The sensibility of Irina really just, it was an expression of both Anthony and Nigel's feelings about what our arts programme should be. They'd be quite hard on you, but they'd give you a fair amount of freedom. I took Anthony an idea once, I can't remember what it was, but he, you know, he dismissed it out of hand, he really didn't like it. I think it, I seem to remember him sort of screwing up and throwing it in the bin. And he just said to me, he said, just cultivate your prejudices. I'm a coolery the first, I'm a coolery
the follow. Eddie Cochran will always live in the minds of all the true Teddy boys who ever listened to rock and roll. Eddie Cochran still lives, same as Elvis still lives, or Buddy Holly, or any of the others who've died. Their music lives on.
It was just like any other arts programme. It was about a reasonably well-respected rock star. It was about British culture. It sort of had all the stuff in that you'd want in a programme.
When did you first know that you were in love? And he said, the first time I ever saw you. Well, with that, of course, I want to take off my shoe and beat him over the head. You know, I said, you made me, you know, I chased you for 2 years. Made a fool out of myself in front of everybody in the industry. And he said, I had to be real sure.
I was faintly skeptical of Sharon Shealy and her position in this. I like to think that we try to convey the fact that you don't necessarily have to take this person absolutely seriously. There was a sort of sense of romance about her relationship with Cochran. But as she gave it to us like a fairy story, it seemed easy enough to sort of continue that sort of motif.
Soon Eddie and I would be married. It was a long drive. The chauffeur told us it would take 8 hours to get to the airport. We were all too tired to take the train. We thought it would be much more comfortable sitting in the back seat of that car. Why are we going so fast, I guess, driver? Don't you think that we should slow down?
Now there. I shot that interview very wide. I had this sort of sense that if you can see the whole body, you can see the body language. I heard the American cameraman saying to Nigel, you sure about this? And Nigel going, well, it's his film. So even Nigel wasn't that certain about it.
This is Eddie's guitar.
And she let it into her little house in Orange County. It was a shrine to Eddie, really, and she hadn't touched the bedroom since Cochran had not returned from his trip to the UK. But I could feel that there was something hugely emotional going on, and so all I really had to do was sort of react, to be honest.
I didn't get all of his clothes back, of course, you know. But what I did get, I have saved.
Is anybody allowed into the room?
No. No one.
I think there was probably a certain kind of artist that there was a natural inclination to go towards, which perhaps somebody slightly on the edge.
Je crois que sur mon casier judiciaire, il y a 14 condamnations. C'est vous dire que j'étais en effet un mauvais voleur puisque je faisais toujours point.
He was a legendary figure to me. I just loved his work. I thought, I'd read Our Lady of the Flowers, I thought it was a masterpiece, and I thought the plays were brilliant. And for some reason, Jenny decided we were all right, so we thought, this is a rare opportunity we've got. And I remember he asked for 10 grand, his agent asked for 10 grand for the interview. And this is a long time ago, it was a lot of money.
Écoutez, vous croyez en Dieu?
Quelquefois.
Alors, demandez-lui. Demandez-lui si ma vie aurait été changée. Moi, je ne sais pas.
So what happened halfway through the interview, he said, he had a real go at me. Pourquoi poser ces questions? I said, c'est simplement, c'est mon travail. I work for the BBC and I have a mortgage. He said, okay, fair enough. Carry on. We did the interview on 2 days. And the second day, he does this thing, which I think is in the finished programme, which he says, I have a dream last night. I dreamt that the technicians revolted. And why do you not talk to the technicians?
Assistant à une prise de vue, à la préparation d'un film, ils n'ont jamais droit à la parole. Comment ça se fait? Et je pensais qu'il serait assez culotté, parce qu'on parlait hier de culotté, pour me chasser de la place et prendre ma place. Et néanmoins, ils ne bougent pas. Comment... vous pouvez leur demander comment ils expliquent ça?
Oui. Comment ils...
Ils expliquent ça. Pourquoi ils ne viennent pas me chasser, vous chasser aussi, puis venir dire... Merci. C'est tellement bête ce que vous dites. Merci. Que je n'ai pas du tout envie de continuer ce travail. Demandez-leur.
Oui, bien sûr. Parce qu'il ne parle pas français. Oui,
what
Jean is saying is he doesn't understand why you don't get up. And he had a dream last night, and you took over the film, and you sat in his place. And he thinks that he's very surprised that you don't do that now.
Le preneur de son aussi.
Yes, and that's Duncan as well.
But it was great theatre, so we ran with it.
So,
and
do you have anything to say to that?
Of course, the reason we ran with it was we had fantastic respect for Genet as a writer, and we were afraid of him. If you're afraid of somebody and really respect them, it means you sort of indulge them, but also there's a lot at stake, and you feel that, I think, in the film. There's a huge amount at stake intellectually, because his complete challenging stance on almost everything.
Ça marche, la caméra? Très bien. Je vous ai dit hier que vous faisiez un travail de flic.
Oui.
Et vous le continuez maintenant, ce matin. Et je vous l'ai dit hier et vous l'avez déjà oublié.
You did feel with him, you were sort of taking your life in your hands. But he was the last person I've ever met who really impressed me. I've never met, since then, I've done films about people I really admire and like, but no one like him, really.
We all had an affection for the old Monitor films, because they seemed to be our natural predecessors.
Elgar bought himself a bike, and despite all setbacks, almost certainly felt an enormous relief.
When Ken Russell made the Elgar film, he put in a bicycle to going across the Malvern Hills. Because clearly, how are you going to illustrate the unillustratable? So a man on a bicycle gives some movement to the scene. That's hanky-panky.
Okay, well, you have a straightforward story, but then always, 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 what you do is you think, well, what else can I do with this? How can I turn this around to elevate this subject into, you know, something else, which will reveal something, some truth about it, really? And the way in which you do that is by literally sort of playing with the material. And very often it was a case of discovery.
Hello, my name is Robert Crumb, and this is my wife, Aileen. We're underground cartoonists.
Essentially, it was a profile, but my approach was to sort of say, well, what can I do with this that's going to turn this around and kind of give it a zing, or, you know, do something different or interesting with it? And we went to see Crumb, and he was incredibly reticent about doing it. So I came up with the idea that he would write it himself. Mainly because he's done some autobiographical cartoon strips.
Maybe there's something wrong with me. Sometimes I really think there's
I have some sort of deep genetic defect or something, some kind of mutation.
And I thought, well, why don't we tell a story via these comic strips? I've got Crumb to write the story, but at the same time address all the questions that one would put to him in a straightforward interview, you know, all those feminist stuff. So he would reenact scenes for us, illustrative stuff. So we, you know, he was okay with his nose up against the window of the gym class, ogling the girls. He was fine about being in the bath with the wife while she's shaving her legs and he's got his hat on. You know, in fact, actually, you know, he couldn't get enough of it. You know, an absolute gift of a contributor, completely up for the hanky-panky and the fun.
Watching all my troubles go dripping down the drain. You're such a big exhibitionist.
Did I get all the hairs off?
Invariably, there's no script. I mean, lots of them don't have any kind of commentary. I mean, I've got nothing against it. But commentary is also a way of getting you out of trouble, papering over the cracks, things that are absolutely, totally unrelated to each other can be done with a little question and, you know, like, and... But would it still be the same in 3 weeks' time? You know, and then you leave, that's a way of going on to something else. And so those kind of faux connections that can easily be made in commentary, and certainly films that tell you what you're about to see, tell you what it is that you're watching while you're watching it, then tell you what you've just seen after you've seen it, are not going to have tension in them. That is absolutely guaranteed.
Prisoners are not allowed to sing. Prisoners are not allowed to whistle. Prisoners are not allowed to treat warders with disrespect.
It was sort of classically an arena subject because it was a microcosm through which you could explore much broader themes.
The spirit of solidarity with our cause was visible, and we could cut it with a knife.
A very large percentage of the ANC leadership had been in this prison on this island for various lengths of time. Within virtually days of this film going out, half the cast were in the cabinet. But the thing about it was that we weren't offering them a political platform. You know, they were talking about the experience of being in this situation, in this prison, and the culture, you know, that evolves. So it's about sports, it's about all sorts of things.
There were guys who were involved in ballroom dancing before they came to prison. So they taught some of us who have never been introduced, you know, to the art. So we would do these things in the cells, and there would be competitions, and for an outstanding pair, you know, there would be not a club, because the club would attract the attention of the warders, that there's something of an entertainment that is going on in the cell, which was supposed not to be the case, because the cell was supposed to be a place of gloom, of brooding and anxiety and all that kind of thing. But we brightened up the cell, you know, and engaged in this kind of activity. So for an outstanding performance, the chairperson would say, give them a brush. The brush would be like this, not a club like this, because a club would attract their attention.
And we interviewed Mandela's warder, who was very, very surprising, and I think very surprising to an English audience. I mean, I think that was the moment at which you could look deeper into the South African political spectrum than had been previously the case. And people here hadn't been willing, really, to see South African politics in anything other than very stark, good, bad, black, white, evil, good, you know.
He calls me James, and I call him Mr. Mandela.
Didn't it feel weird to you that you were the warder and he was the prisoner?
Not really. I think we understood each other too well.
He was one of the most refined warders, well-informed and courteous with everybody, soft-spoken, very good observations. I developed a lot of respect for him.
He haunts me. He's a very present force.
Nigel came from a very ordinary background, but he was a bit of an exotic himself. And first of all, he was incredibly arty. He was passionate about art, more passionate than sort of anyone I knew.
Without being personal, I would say that Nigel Finch has done it to me. He made me angry when it was the time to talk about the contract, right? He pushed me so much that I did get angry, and then he got what he wanted, that is to say, the absence. So I'm a real pushover, but I am, I know that. Which doesn't fix things, it makes things even worse.
He was the most energetic to the point of exasperation person, naturally, and was just always on and always wanted to be going forward. What's the next one? You know, was talking about the ideas for the next films and everything. He was someone who would take risks, as he did in his life. He, you know, experimented sexually. I mean, if you'd have said to me that Nigel was gay, or to Anthony and I, that Nigel was gay for a long while, well, Nigel wasn't gay. Nigel was just intrigued by things, and if he fell for them, he fell for them. Man or woman or whatever subject it was. He relished sort of new opportunities.
I mean, he was a beautiful man and a beautiful force of energy.
It's hard to be precise because it was also overwhelming, the idea that that he wasn't there. It was very odd doing the same thing but as a completely different experience. I don't know if you really recover from something like that.
The work carried on, but my God, there was half a hole left, really. And I know Anthony, you know, everyone felt it for a long time afterwards. It was real, real loss, real loss.
I mean, the issue was really whether to carry on or not, I think. And I think I just had enough people saying that you ought to carry on.
I thought when Nigel died, Anthony would give up, stop making Arena, because they'd been such a brotherly double act. But I think maybe it gave him sort of extra impetus that everything they'd worked for shouldn't just kind of go.
Our nationality seems so natural, but is it as simple as that?
The most ambitious thing that we ever did from an editing point of view was called Stories My Country Told Me in 96, which was a night about nations and nationalism. And it was also one of the most difficult intellectually.
But I think a lot of younger people today have enormous problems in identifying not so much their formal state citizenship and documents, but with their community, chiefly because the world is changing so fast. I mean, you find, for instance, that all these young Jewish kids who go to Israel and become ultra-passionate, they seek for their roots. Everybody's looking for their roots. But one of the reasons I look for their roots is their roots aren't there anymore.
In the early 90s, nationalism, with the Yugoslav war happening, was an absolutely kind of key issue. And Nationality Night was an idea to be able to give filmmakers, beyond a short report or an hour, the chance to really get underneath this big subject.
I thought that we could take four stories of four significant and thinking individuals whose lives had been in some way seriously affected by issues of nationalism. And each of the four chapters intercut the four stories to a final resolution where Desmond Tutu goes to see his mentor, Bishop Trevor Huddleston, who's effectively dying in his hospital bed in his mid to late 80s, and just throws Tutu completely by saying, when he meets God, he's got some serious questions to ask him about why does it have to be this way. So it leaves you with this question mark.
Why has God said, part of your education, chums, is to suffer? Whether you're innocent or guilty, you're going to suffer. He didn't have to say that. He could have created a world completely free of suffering. Yes. So why did he create a world of suffering in it? I find it a tormenting question. Yes. It's the first question I shall ask if I get the chance.
Adios, compadre. What must be, remember to name one muchacho for me. I ride to the Rio, where my life...
In the late 90s, the scene at the BBC was pretty ugly. And we'd had a regime that really turned things upside down. And for Arena that had been steaming away like crazy, the situation was really very tricky. I thought, well, maybe now, in this chaos that's raging here, this kind of Murdoch-driven frenzy, maybe Arena's gonna go.
One of the things Arena did was to take a little idea and expand that idea. And sometimes the idea didn't merit the extension. So I think self-indulgence was also, in a way, a watchword for Arena. I mean, it was encouraged. That's what hanky-panky meant. But of course, sometimes the programmers were self-indulgent. I mean, they really didn't. So, obviously it has a fantastic record of success, but there was a period of self-indulgence or fatigue. In a 30-year history, that happens.
Mary Sweeney, who has been creating trouble all over the state with her wild mania for breaking windows, has finally been captured. This woman has a history, being intelligent and well-educated, and she once taught school at Stevens Point. Mary says she doesn't know why she breaks windows, and only does it when the craze seizes her. She uses cocaine liberally on such occasions, saying it quiets her nerves.
Anthony had a fantastic capacity for anger. I think it was his anger that protected Arena within the sort of within the bureaucratic sort of world of the BBC. You know, he kept it going through sheer bloody-mindedness. I think he'd been a sort of calmer, sort of more equitable person, Arena wouldn't have survived. You know, it was Arena against the world.
Anthony reacted by becoming very political, actually. He impresses me by the way that he's become so deft at surviving.
She was at the Manger Bar alone. She met the swarthy man somewhere. She dropped her car off somewhere and got into his car.
Adam are doing a two-hour program about me.
Wonderful.
On the BBC.
the joy of arena, there isn't a script, it's not prescribed, there isn't a presenter. What happens is you're making a film on Francis Bacon. Which film? Which Francis Bacon? It's the one that emerges largely in the cutting room. So you don't know what it's going to be like at the beginning, but you're going on gut instincts, you're going on feelings, you're going on knowledge, you're going on past experience. It's exciting.
Well, I think probably the sort of basic way Arena looks at films and makes films and thinks about films hasn't changed, but maybe the nature of what's possible to do now has changed.
And every Sunday evening, out in her home I dwell.
I always saw this as not just a film that would be shown on British television. In fact, it's being shown theatrically in America at the moment, and it will be released on DVD, and all the things that, you know, you would expect from a feature film is happening to Arena. And there's a big interest in documentary, feature-length documentaries and feature documentaries.
An artist has got to be careful never really to arrive at a place where he thinks he's at somewhere. You always have to realize that you're constantly in a state of becoming. As long as you can stay in that realm, you'll sort of be all right.
Because of his status, Scorsese has been able to make a film in the way that somebody should be able to make a film, i.e. with his singular vision, the way he wants to make, with everybody assisting him in his enterprise, not trying to hinder him, and that that enterprise should be regarded as the primary function of the whole project. I do hope film shootings, I have to say. I think we live in a culture that seems to be utterly obsessed with finishing things. I don't know, I can't remember who said this about a poem, that a poem's never finished, it's only abandoned. I feel a bit like that with the programme sometimes, and I'm actually trying to think of a film that I could start making that never needed to be finished. And he does imagine things.
I see. Have you got a car?
You know, I haven't.
No, I'm
terrible. Should we get him?
Let me go.
Anthony Wall.
Wall, yeah.
Yeah.
That's a great program.
Good, thanks.